come with.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Michael Walker. This is the Data Science Association. It is Wednesday, November 5th, 2014. We have a great show for you today. It's Spark Gotchas and Anti-Patterns and Julia Language. Spark Anti-Patterns is by Michael Malak. I want to tell you a little bit about Michael Malak. He's my partner in crime at the Data Science Association, and he has been a wonderful colleague, a great friend, and to be quite honest, I couldn't do it without Michael Malak. He's one of the smartest people I've ever met, and he deserves a lot of credit for the success. So everybody, thank you, Michael. And also Galen O'Neill is here from NIST, and he's going to be talking about Julia language. Julia language is really something fantastic because it combines the dynamic capabilities of Python and R with the speed of C and Fortran, and that's something we're really going to need for the future. We're going to be back in Boulder next month at Atlas, so we're going to be happy to get the Boulder crowd again. And then we have some wonderful things planned for the spring. We have a machine learning hackathon that's being planned for some time in the spring. We have, in partnership with the University of Colorado, Paco Nathan, who will be coming in, and we have a number of other wonderful speakers and guests. One thing I was thinking about this election season, the last month, we've all been bombarded with all these slick political advertisements. And I thought to myself, you know, I can't really tell what's real. I can't tell what these candidates really believe. I get the feeling that they have used data science techniques to profile me, and they're telling me exactly what I want to hear. But that's not their real agenda. I felt that they were really cloaking their real agenda, who they really were, what their real policy goals were, in a mystery. And I just couldn't, you know, figure it out. And then Michael Malak wrote a wonderful blog post saying, well, you know, aren't our political masters using data science to invert democratic theory? You know, democratic theory is that politicians are supposed to lay out their policy goals and what they want to do, and then the voters get a chance to ratify or reject it. Or if an elected official is in office, we get a chance to take a look at their policies, how they've enacted. We have some facts and evidence, and we can, vote them back into office or get them out and let somebody new try. But then I thought, I can't even figure out if these policies are really working. You know, I tried looking at different data. I was so confused, and I thought, this is something of a public service. Data science could really add huge value to the public if we had a third-party organization that could actually collect the data, look at the facts and evidence, and then figure out with the different candidates and the political leaders, what are their real agendas? What are their real policies, as opposed to what the slick advertisement or any, you know, of the marketing is trying to sell me on? And then I can make an informed decision, because if us, the public, the voters, don't have good quality information, how can we really make our democracy work, right? It's, you know, it's very unhealthy, I think, the state of affairs that we've come to. And I think politicians and political leaders are using data science against the public, against us, and we need to fight back. We need to take it, and we need to give people the right information so that they can become our servants again instead of our political masters. Anyway, my sermon is over. Thank you very much. So without further ado, we'll start with Michael Malak and Spark. Thank you.
All right, so how many people have used Spark before?
show of hands. How many people have watched my April 2013 presentation? How many people have done neither? All right, so I included about two slides for the Spark 101 for everybody else to catch up. So this is the Berkeley Data Analytics Stack. Actually, HDFS and Yarn are just Hadoop. The rest of the blue is approximately the stack. These things down here can be used independently, Sysinct, Tachyon, and Mesos. This stack diagram is probably taken about 3 months ago. There were some changes. I think they've finally given up on the name Shark. It's just SparkSQL now. And, so that was the big switcheroo, right, in 1.0, where they got rid of Shark and brought in SparkSQL. And I think they liked the name Shark so much they were thinking of hanging on to it on the rename product. And so for a while it was SharkSQL, but it's just SparkSQL now. And now there's another layer up at the tippy top, Adam, for bioinformatics. Just some Spark 101 here. So whereas Hadoop was distributed data through a cluster on disks, Spark is distributed data through a cluster in RAM. So that's Spark 101. Spark originally came out of AmpLab, out of the University of Berkeley. And that was the end of 2011, I think. And then in 2013, it became an Apache project. It was pretty much fast-tracked. It was like Apache incubator in the spring and a full-fledged project by the summer or something. And then the geniuses out of AmpLab went in to the startup, Databricks. And so this is, there's actually a gotcha here because of the overlapping concerns here, right? So Databricks is going to have a proprietary piece, their notebook in the cloud, and then, you know, we're caught us by surprise. Again, this getting rid of Shark all of a sudden, everybody's like, hey, you can't do that. And then, AmpLab Databricks guys were like, well, Shark was never part of Apache. And they're like, oh, well, I guess you're right. So, just some meta about this presentation. You too can do a presentation like this. People really know, like when they adopt a new technology, a new stack, to sign up for the mailing list, but you can really get even more information if you just log on to JIR every day and, order by reverse chronological and just see what the heck is going on. So if there's anything I missed, you can probably find it in JIR. And that's where I store a lot of this information. I don't actually have firsthand experience with every component. So we'll start in with the core. First, anti-pattern. Ignore partitioning. So here we have a group by, because we all come from a SQL world, we like group bys. There's a potential performance penalty here because behind the scenes, it's changing your partitioning scheme. Group by key automatically changes whatever partitioning you had into a partitioning by key, and so we actually end up with a couple of machines in our cluster lying fallow, so any subsequent computation is only going to use half our cluster. So there are many potential ways around this. One way around it is to change your key here. So here we just took our first letter here, we could change our key to be the first two letters, and it would be more evenly distributed. Of course, that implies some algorithm changes as well, and there are other ways to get around this, like you'll see in a future slide, using reduced by key instead of group by key. Next, anti-pattern, ignore garbage collection. So this is just JVM stuff right here. If you have 100 gigs allocated for your JVM, every time it does a garbage collection, that JVM just shuts down for 300 seconds, 5 minutes at a time. And now you can get servers with 1 or 6 terabytes, and you can see this is just scaling up linearly. So 1 terabyte would be 50 minutes, 6 terabytes, what is that, 5 hours or something. There are a couple solutions. One is you can use Tachyon. Tachyon was written specifically for this purpose. It's a layer that is basically a RAM disk. So when Spark runs out of memory, or you can tell it to prefer disk, Spark runs out of memory, or because you specify your preference that you want to store it to disk, you can store in HDFS, but TACDOWN is also a file system based in RAM, so Spark can offload some of its data onto TACDOWN. So TACDOWN, I think the top layers are in Java, but the point is that it uses the Linux, you know, RAM file system to store its data. And so you can offload your data off that nasty JVM heap onto your Linux heap. The other potential solution is to break up your node into multiple workers. So if your physical hardware node has a terabyte of RAM, then you can, you know, break it up into 20 workers. And so somebody's actually done a study. This study isn't really focused on the RAM issue so much, but just the general issue of having multiple workers per node. And this, at first glance, this chart is a little difficult to interpret, but obviously we want speed up to be maximized. And so the maximum speed up here is this line here, which is number 3. So this chart, for whatever initial conditions they had, and here's the URL, 3 workers per node was optimal. There are many things that go into that, so you're just going to have to do trial by error. All right, our first gotcha. You know, the natural thing to think of of Spark is as a data store that's stored in RAM. And so you might want to share this data between multiple applications. It's a natural inclination, but it's not really possible. So what are the alternatives? Again, you can use TACDOWN, and then there's a new layer on TACDOWN that you can use called Synced, which is just a key value store. The other possible solution, which is also not necessarily what you want, is since, you know, the limitation here is that your RDD is tied to a particular Spark context, just have one process continually running that has your Spark context, and all your requests have to be transmitted to it somehow. I mean, when you do this, you're losing the nice Spark API. I mean, you're essentially going to be creating your own API, your own web service or whatever to service these requests. So right now there's no way to share RDDs. Another thing you might want to do if you're really putting Spark into production is have some elasticity to its capacity and being able to add hot add nodes to your cluster. Now, I don't have direct experience with adding nodes to a cluster, but based on my research, it looks like Yarn might be able to do it, probably can do it, because you can edit the config files and tell Yarn to reload those config files. Mesos, based on these outstanding Jira tickets, looks to me like you have to bring the cluster down and back up when you change its configuration. All right, the next anti-pattern is, you know, thinking what I just told you at the very beginning of this presentation, that Spark is an in-memory thing, and it's not. You're periodically going to need to do a shuffle, and similar to Hadoop, those shuffles are written out to disk. And I stole this diagram from Aaron Davidson in Spark Summit this past summer. But it's not quite as brain dead as Hadoop. And in fact, in Spark 1.2 coming out, I think it's slated for December. Does anybody know? Spark 1.2, they're making a slight improvement where after a shuffle, the reduce gets assigned to the physical node where the largest shuffle file happens to be. Next anti-pattern is what I hinted at in the beginning, the reduce by key. So this was a great presentation from Spark Summit July 2014, again from Eric Davidson. This is directly out of his presentation. I stole it wholesale. And so he started off with this seemingly simple problem and source code. So the problem is you have a list of first names, and you want to count how many first names begin with each particular letter. How many first names begin with A, how many first names begin with B, and so forth. And so any Spark programmer will recognize this is the natural, straightforward way to do it. But it was amazing in this presentation. He just, slide after slide, he's like, oh, we can optimize this, we can optimize this. And so he did many things. One of the things that he did was he replaced the group by key with a reduce by key. So he thereby got rid of the shuffle. So the reduce by key goes out to each node, each partition, and does the reduce there, adds up the names, and then you're just left with sums that get transmitted back to the driver, and that's not much to transmit, just a few sums. Next anti-pattern is ignoring map partitions. So this is another wholesale theft. Patrick Wendell's presentation in 2013, Spark Summit, and he chose to use Python. I don't normally use Python with Spark, even though I love IPython notebook, so you'll just have to live with the Python. But the point here is that he's doing an expensive operation here. He's creating a database cursor. And if you read this, he's doing it inside a map. So he's creating one new cursor for every element of his RDD. So if he has a million elements in his RDD, he's creating a million cursors. So that's obviously not very desirable. So the alternative is map partitions. And so this is going to create a cursor and destroy it once for every partition. So remember what a partition is. A partition is assigned to a worker, and there are multiple workers on the node, and a worker has a single core. So it's okay that we do this old-fashioned for loop here. Old-fashioned for loop, completely sequential, but it's okay because it's a single core. So we're getting the parallelism of having multiple workers, multiple nodes, but within each core, we're doing a serial operation in between the creation and destruction of that cursor. Next anti-pattern, getting stuck with cryo. Now, the situation has improved massively in 1.0 and 1.1, but you start playing with cryo and you realize your serialization isn't working. So what do I mean by cryo for those who may not be familiar? So in Spark, when you transmit data, everything has to be serialized. So that means it has to be serializable. So your three alternatives are to use the built-in Java serialization called serializable, use the built-in Java interface called externalizable, and write your own serialization or leverage a serial compression library. Or you can use cryo, and Spark has first-class knowledge of cryo. So, and cryo is 10 times as fast as Java's built-in serialization. So in the goal of optimizing performance, the natural temptation is, okay, well, let's switch from serializable to cryo. And then as soon as you do that, you often run into problems. I think the major outstanding one at this point is trying to use cryo with Avro, which is not an uncommon use case, in particular complex Avro objects, arrays, and structures, and so forth. And there's also problems with Snappy. I suppose, based on my reading of Jira tickets, life is better now. I haven't actually tried to use cryo since 0.9, so it might be safe, probably is safe, if you're not doing anything too complex. Mixing accumulators with lazy operations. So accumulators are naturally imperative, sort of defecty, and Spark is naturally functional and lazy. So the output of this, so we have an accumulator here, and we're incrementing it inside a map, which is lazy, so the output is zero. Based on the slide so far, what is a good alternative? Map partitions. So if we didn't know about map partitions, okay, the naive solution to this problem would be to replace this map with a for each. Well, what that would do is it would just bring everything into the driver and do everything completely sequential. But we know from the previous that we can use map partitions and we can do everything sequentially, but only for each core. So we can parallelize throughout the cores, but sequential within each core. And then our side effecty accumulator starts working. All right, so now I'm going to talk about Spark Streaming, the one I probably have the most experience with. First, anti-pattern, ignore closure. Now, as I was coming up with titles for these slides, it seemed to me like it was starting to sound like a Weird Al song. But before I talk about closure, let's sort of talk about what closure is. And if there are any functional programming purists, I'm sure you will volunteer any correction of definitions I'm providing here. But closure is basically bundling up data with the functions. So the whole point of functional programming is you pass functions around. And so here we're defining a function called multiplier with the obvious intent that we're going to be passing it around in the future. But of course, multiplier depends on factor. So if we want to pass around multiplier, our functional programming system is going to have to bundle up factor along with multiplier and ship it out. So Scala has closure. Scala does not have closure combined with serialization. There is a library out there called Spores. There was an intention to include it in Scala 2.11. It didn't make it. And of course, Spark was written eons ago, 2011. So they wrote their own. Amplode wrote their own library to do closure with serialization. So Spark has serializable closure, even though Scala does not. So when you're writing Spark code, it can be kind of confusing that all this stuff, all this Spore-like functionality, is going on behind the scenes. So back to the example. Another example I stole wholesale this from a blog. So the key here issue is JSON parser. So first of all, it has to be serializable. And so that's sort of independent of the closure issue. Everything in Spark has to be serializable. But beside that, the way this is currently written, it sort of assumes JSON parser is stateless. It's probably not a good assumption, but if it does have state, which it probably does, then you would need to move JSON parser declaration and instantiation to inside the map. Because if you don't, what's really going on there is it gets instantiated over here in the driver, and you're going to serialize that one instance out to every worker node, and it's going to get its own copy of the JSON parser. Which is okay if it's stateless, but if it's stateful, which it probably is, you're going to want each worker to instantiate its own fresh JSON parser. Now, the real issue that created this slide in the first place is where you really run into trouble is if you move this declaration. So assume JSON parser is stateless for the moment. If you move this declaration to outside the main, to here, or especially out to here, Spark Streaming just throws all kinds of exceptions. It gets totally confused because it's trying to create a closure of this declaration with this function and ship it out. And at least when I was doing it in point 9, there was just unexplained exceptions if you moved any variable declarations that are used in your functions outside the domain, or especially as global variables. Ah, yes. So, graceful shutdown. So you write your first Spark Streaming program, and it's running, and it's streaming, and it's like, yeehaw, how do you stop this thing? It's like George Jetson. And there are really issues at both the API and the application layer. So, like in Spark Point 9, if you did SSC stop, Spark Streaming context stop, and if you looked at the source code behind that, it was just like kill thread, kill thread, kill thread. It was just nothing graceful. Evidently, they fixed that in 1.0 and 1.01. I mean, it's really important, especially if you're inputting from Kafka. Because you want to close your Kafka gracefully so that it commits your high watermarks back to ZooKeeper. I looked in Java, evidently there's still some issues if you're using a socket receiver. So a socket receiver is where you're implementing your own TCP/IP protocol custom. And this really isn't a shutdown issue. This is actually a startup issue, but it's kind of related because, like I said, the important part of Kafka is getting your, making sure you're not losing data, making sure your high water marks are set correctly. So there's an issue where if you have auto offset reset set, Spark Streaming will just wipe out all your high water marks. At the application level, right, so even if we had graceful shutdown, there's still an issue at the application level, right? So if we wanted to shut this down, if we said my Kafka input dstream.stop, okay, it stops, but there's still data flowing through here, okay? And you could do some timeouts, but if you wanted something more deterministic, or if you have a situation where your data is bursty, timeouts may be difficult to implement reliably. So there's a trick you can do, which is to shove a magic token down your pipeline. So you can merge these streams here, and then just wait for your magic done down here at the bottom. And so the way this works is, well, let's go through the main. All right, so this line here really doesn't have anything to do with Spark Streaming. This is just how we know when to stop our program. This looks for a file to exist, as it's assuming you're going to do a touch file, and when it exists, then the main can continue. So then the next thing is that stop on the Kafka input stream that I talked about. And then we shove our magic done, and in here you can maybe put a delay in here before you do that. And then we just wait for this receive stop flag to be set, and that's how we know we can really stop. So the receive stop is set when it detects this magic done coming through. Now, you can't just blindly shove this into your queue. I mean, your transforms here are assuming that they're going to be looking for URLs, they might be looking for slashes or something like that. So every step of the way, you're going to have to sort of pass through this magic done unscathed, so it actually comes out here at the bottom. So you look for your magic done and you set this flag. But wait a minute, does Spark really have global variables? Why does this work? It works because this is a for each, and for each always gets done on the driver. So you can reference a global variable in the driver, or a local variable, a local global variable. Associated with graceful shutdown and startup is saving and restoring the state. So the most important API call in Spark Streaming is update state by key. So the typical use case is, or atypical use case is, you could have a hit count for each of your web pages, say, or a hit count for each product bought. So your key would be the URL for that web page, and the state would be an integer counting how many times people hit that. So the normal update state by key calls you once for every key. It says, okay, here's your old state, here's a list, a sequence of URLs. So remember, Spark Streaming is based on micro-batches. So if you set your micro-batch to 10 seconds, this will be all the URLs that came in the last 10 seconds. This is your for that key. All the URLs in the last 10 seconds for that one key. Here's your previous state, and Spark Streaming is expecting you to give it back the new state. So if you're trying to do save and restore state, so you shut down your cluster or your process, do some maintenance and turn it back on, and you go into here, all your states are going to be zero again. So how do you reload your old states? Well, there is an outstanding jury ticket to handle that, but you don't have to wait for that. If you look in the APIs, there are four overloaded versions of update state by key, and one of them has a completely different signature for the callback that you need to provide.
Excuse me, there's a really bad echo on the live stream.
Let's take a look at that.
Yeah. May want to switch. multi-directional microphone.
Okay, well, we'll just switch that.
Yeah, it's a really bad echo. Sorry.
So this other signature, you actually get all the keys at the same time, and what you return are all the keys in all the states. So if you're restarting your cluster from scratch, initially, the first time that your callback gets called, you'll have an empty set of keys, but you can just return your full set of keys that you've deserialized. All right, overrunning batch duration. This kind of works, right? So we talked about micro batches. So say you set your micro batch to 10 seconds, but your processing ends up taking 15 seconds. Well, in my experience, and officially, that's okay if it happens once or twice, but officially it's actually undefined behavior. And I have seen it where if you get too far behind, it totally loses its mind. So there isn't a good solution to this. Really, all you can do is set your batch size to your worst case instead of the average cases, which is what you would really like to do. And so that means that the implication is that there's a batch size trade-off. So if you would like a 10-second batch, you can say set it to 2 minutes, and that will handle any burstiness. Right? It gives you some flexibility, some elasticity. But if you're setting it to 2 minutes, that means your output out of Spark Streaming is going to have a latency of 2 minutes. All right, so this is one of the big shortfalls of Spark Streaming compared to Storm. Storm API allows you to ACK or not ACK when you receive something from higher up in your DAG, your directed acyclic graph. Spark Streaming has no such concept. If you have an error, an exception, or a timeout, you have no way of notifying upstream that they need to preserve that data for later retransmission or anything like that. Evidently, reading JIRA, there is some concept of that. Somebody who is used to Flume and Storm came to Spark Streaming and was like, hey, you don't have rollback. So they implemented it for Flume, but I don't think it's implemented for any other data source. Another gotcha, and this is just Kafka. This has nothing to do with Spark. Kafka is at least once, so you could end up double counting. Well, the good news is Kafka is exactly once, provided none of the nodes in the Kafka cluster go down. So, it only does that if something goes wrong. And this is something you might want to do, multiple Kafka input streams. So if you have a real-time feed from two different internal systems, you might want to union or join them together somehow, and this evidently still doesn't work. All right, so the next module I'm going to talk about is GraphX, which I've actually used this past summer. So the big hamper in GraphX is that, like everything else in Spark and Scala, or especially Spark RDDs, graphs are immutable, which is kind of a problem if you have a big graph. I mean, functional programming people like everything to be immutable, but if your data collection size is approaching the size of your RAM, you run into trouble. They actually have a solution coming out in 1.2, which again, I think is coming out in December. There's going to be a completely new type of RDD, a mutable RDD. And one of the prime motivations for creating the index RDD is for GraphX. And it's actually useful for everything else. So this will be a great thing to have mutable RDDs if we have large ones. This is the other big surprise in GraphX. Our RDF is a standard file format for non-property graphs. And so there are a lot of standard RDF files you can get out there, like some files that are derived from Wikipedia. But there's no built-in function in GraphX to read them, which is something every other graph processing system in the world has. So the solution is to wait for the book I'm writing. I'm going to include code in that. Actually, I should say I'm not writing it. So 3 weeks ago, Michael Walker begged me to put this presentation together. I said, well, I just got a contract. I'm going to get a contract to write a book. He said, well, it'll be fine. So tomorrow, I'm going to start writing this book. So GraphX comes with a number of algorithms, PageRank, Triangle Count, a few others. But I'm not a patent lawyer, intellectual property lawyer. But it seems to me illegal to even download Spark. You know, Spark includes GraphX because it's patented. I stole this out of Wikipedia, the list of patents. I mean, I'm not a lawyer, but my understanding from patent law is it's certainly illegal to use it for commercial purposes, but I think it's even illegal to own a copy of the code. But it makes for a good demo. GraphX performance lags behind most other graph processing systems, especially those written in C++, because GraphX is written in Java. This is an article that came out recently. They actually have about 9 graphs. They have like 3 different algorithms, and I don't know. This was typical though. So Spark was near the worst in terms of runtime. GraphX, that is. Okay. Next one is going to be SparkSQL, formerly known as SharkSQL. So the big hang-up you initially run into is if you have your Hive QL queries ready to go, there's a good chance they might not work. But a lot of that's getting fixed in 1.2. Some things are still open and not have no certain resolution date. And then this is another major issue. Again, it's going to get fixed in 1.2. And this is the ongoing war right now on the Spark dev mailing list, if you've seen it, where Impala is running twice as fast as, or Impala 2.0, which just came out, is running twice as fast as SparkSQL, and the Databricks guys are like, well, they might not have optimized or performance tuned their queries, and then the Impala advocates are, well, we tried to optimize this as best we could. But it does seem like in the end, Impala is going to be a bit faster than SparkSQL. And so that brings us to our next anti-pattern, ignore performance tuning. So don't think just because you're on Spark, you can ignore performance tuning. And just like every other SQL or SQL-like system out there, you need to pay attention to things like this. Data skipping was a nice feature of Shark that was not in the initial version of SparkSQL. So this is this clever thing that IBM sort of adopted first. They might have invented it, where if you're searching for a range of values in combination with other clauses in your query, Shark broke up the data into what's called blocks. So blocks are much smaller than partitions, and it could ignore blocks that didn't meet that metadata criteria. It can ignore those blocks completely, and so that's called data skipping. And so warp is the full data skipping implemented, and you can see it gives a 10 times performance improvement. SparkSQL will regain data skipping in 1.2. All right, we're almost done. BlinkDB. So BlinkDB allows you to do approximate summations, for example, or approximate queries. So if you have a million data records, numeric, and you want to average them together, BlinkDB can go through and sample that data. And the interesting thing about BlinkDB is it introduces new keywords into the SQL language, where you can say, I want my answer to be accurate within X percent. And it will automatically figure out how many data samples it needs to sample to get to within that precision. But the problem is, BlinkDB still depends on 0.9. So again, this is another thing that's AMPLAB but not Apache. MLLib. I only have a couple of slides on this. So you start messing around with MLLib if you come from Mahout or Scikit. You may notice some things are missing. Parameters are missing. Algorithms are missing, like neural networks. But that improves drastically with each additional new version of Spark. And that might be it. I kind of ran out of time. I didn't have anything for Yarn, but I don't actually have any direct experience with Yarn. But I mean, looking at the Jira tickets, there are, I did a filter, and there are just dozens of tickets that are major, critical, or blocker that are still open. And that sort of meshes with, you know, what I hear over the cubicle wall from my colleague Kevin Markey as he tries to get Spark and Yarn to work together. And then when Gwen Shapiro is here at Oracle, where I work, she kind of confirmed that. She's like, yeah, there's one guy, Cloudera, he's just focused on Spark and Yarn. So you might be in for a bumpy ride if you're implementing in Yarn. I think that is the end of my presentation, so I'm looking to see if any Spark experts here have any gotchas or anti-patterns that they would like to add to my collection. I covered everybody's knowledge. Go ahead.
I have to say, like, you were, one of your early ones was about memory and garbage collection.
Yeah.
And, you know, you were talking about, like, stop the world pauses pretty much.
Yeah.
So, are you just trying to, like, let people know that that's not required in Java and that you can tune the garbage collector to do the different types of GC so that you don't get the stop the worlds? Or are you saying that the way Spark runs, it leads to stop the world because of generation garbage collection?
My understanding is that was the motivation behind creating Tachyon. So if you know of a way to avoid that, so there's a way to tune the Java garbage collector so it doesn't stop the world.
While it's possible to tune the garbage collection, it is generally way more difficult the bigger is your data set. Because at the end of the day, sooner or later, maybe the garbage collection will happen.
Mm-hmm.
And really the problem with stop the world is that tuning just reduces the frequency of major garbage collection. And then it finally occurs, then it is proportional in general to the heap size. And what they're saying is if you're keeping the heap size to be small, then when it hits you, it doesn't hit you as high.
True. You're right, you're delaying, essentially you're delaying the full GC. Mm-hmm. But you can delay that full GC from a seconds period to like hours and hours and hours, you're still going to hit the full GC. It's going to happen. I wonder though, let's say, I'll put it this way. I wonder if, given the duration of your Spark jobs and the amount of memory you have, whether your generational garbage collector is going to clean out, because the Spark jobs end unless you're caching.
Spark, right? Streaming is continuous.
That's true. But those objects are, okay, you know what, we can take it offline.
That was a good discussion.
I think a lot of the objects are not nearly as long-lived as we, some of the arguments, like if you're caching RDDs, I can totally see that. But from my experience with, yes, I've tuned heavily in production. We've got mega, mega performance gains out of garbage collection tuning, but it's a bear, you don't have to learn it. But, it's one of the, I'll just concede the floor. I think it's something that if you go look at it, you can get a huge boost out of it and save yourself a lot. I bet even in this room.
Good. Maybe you can write the book Spark Operations. I'm looking for an author to write the book in this series. Yeah.
I've got a question for you. Can you talk a little bit about using Spark Streaming with Parquet?
No. Where would the storage actually come in the first place if you're streaming?
Say if you're streaming from Kafka, and what you want to do is you want to persist that RDD into a Parquet file.
Okay.
But Parquet is columnar, and so usually you're building it up in memory, and you don't want to be persisting it every few seconds. Because
right.
Then you'll have millions of little files, and they'll defeat all the compression.
Yeah, I mean, I can just guess as well as you can that you would have to have, you know, some kind of cron job to recompress it. Anything else?
How can you supplement the library? Some say that the big value added of data stacks is really, you know, their, or data bricks is their library.
Well, my understanding is the value add of Databricks is their cloud-based notebook, which is currently in closed beta, because I don't believe they have any proprietary code in their stack, in the stack that we were looking at. Like, that's all open source. Like, this is all open source. So, yeah, I don't think Databricks adds any value to the software in this stack. I think the only value they add is their cloud app, which is in closed beta. So they're not monetizing it. Anything else? All right, we'll turn it over to Galen. Do you want to introduce him?
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Michael. I'm proud to introduce Galen O'Neill. He's going to be talking about Julia language.
Thank you. Oh.